If you were to ask someone what their least favorite part of the natural world is, they would probably answer with something that has to do with disease. Malaria, cancer, COVID, etc. Diseases are everywhere and can be nearly impossible to get rid of. And as you would probably assume, they have been a component of ecosystems for millions and millions of years. A couple weeks ago, I got a comment on one of my videos asking for more information on prehistoric diseases, at least diseases before Homo sapiens. Do we have evidence of these? If so, what? Could this have led to some extinctions of species that seem to have been going well? And I thought, you know what? I've never really looked into that, but I should. I had come across an article about a year ago of a sauropod with the sniffles, but that was about it. And I had the flu last week. I had a fever for like 3 days. And during those days that are now a blur to me, I thought, what better time than now to make this video? Maybe a bit on the nose. But anyway, turns out diseases have shown up in the fossil record in some pretty unusual ways and kind of all over the map. I'm gonna introduce you to a little sample platter of them, specifically during the age of the dinosaurs. So buckle up. Let's first get the general information out of the way. First off, disease is a very broad term. I genuinely can't think of anything more broad than the word disease. It refers to so many things. The simplest way to define it is something that leads to a disorder or disruption in the structure or function of an organism. And a particular disease has a particular set of symptoms and causes. It's so broad, it actually drives me nuts. And there's no way to narrow that scope down for the purpose of this video because we're all over the place today. So we're just gonna leave it at that. Within paleontology, scientists have a name for the study of diseases within fossil specimens. It's called paleopathology. Very nice, very easy. Coined in 1893 when scientists started to take a deeper look into the fractures they had once diagnosed in the bones of extinct animals. Spoiler alert, they were sometimes in fact not fractures. Only a handful of scientists work exclusively on paleopathology, so a lot of diagnosing takes place with a group of experts from all over the map, like, you know, doctors get called in and stuff, so. And as you would probably assume, one of the easiest groups of diseases to identify in fossilized remains are diseases that affected the bones of that animal. For example, bone tumors and bone cancer. Let's start off there. These are documented pretty well in the vertebrate fossil record, with the earliest documented case coming from the Carboniferous period, about 300 million years ago. A bone tumor on a ray-finned fish, and another one on the jaw of a gorgonopsian that was alive in the Permian about 255 million years ago. These earlier documented cases were benign or non-cancerous. Benign tumors seem to be older and much more common than malignant or cancerous ones, with some of the earliest cancerous examples coming from the age of the dinosaurs. Exhibit A, a dinosaur named Centrosaurus with osteosarcoma, a type of bone cancer. It was alive about 76 million years ago in what is now Alberta, Canada. And despite the diagnosis, seems to have been killed in some sort of tropical storm slash flood, along with its herd of over 1,000 individuals. And no, this is not evidence of the flood. It could have been some huge drought too. But you know, mass grave site of a massive herd in an area that likely had tropical storms, you can assume a flood. So all these fossil specimens of this whole herd have been kept at the Royal Tyrrell Museum in Canada. Considering such a large sample size, scientists decided to do a little digging. I'm on a roll today. And see if they could identify anything out of the ordinary. They recognized a shin bone of a particular specimen that seemed to be a little off, and possibly displayed signs of bone cancer. A large mass at one of the ends of the bone had been previously labeled as a healed fracture. But when they compared it to a normal Centrosaurus calf bone and a human calf bone with osteosarcoma, they realized there were signs of osteosarcoma. Got some x-rays and CT scans and shit, which led to a positive diagnosis. And it was advanced. Looking at the scans, the scientists were able to trace the cancer from the knee all the way to the ankle. So it likely spread to other parts of its body, but there's just no way to know for sure with just a shin bone. So this likely would have led to the death of this individual, if not for the flood. Another case of osteosarcoma, this is actually one of the oldest cases discovered, came from an early relative to turtles, no shell yet, called Papakellis. Absolutely darling little guy. They were alive about 240 million years ago during the Triassic and got to about 8 inches long. Scientists noticed a growth on the left femur of this fossil, found in Germany in 2013, took some micro CT scans of it and diagnosed it with osteosarcoma. And more recently in 2021, a hadrosaur that was alive 70 million years ago was also diagnosed with osteosarcoma, Bonapartosaurus, alive in what is now Argentina. The fossil was discovered in the 1980s, and at the time, scientists did notice something unusual about one of the metatarsals, i.e. foot bone, but it was thought to be a possible fracture. Turns out it wasn't. It was osteosarcoma. Once again, hadrosaurs for some reason came up a lot when it came to bone tumors and bone disease and stuff. And it wasn't just a coincidence. Authors in the Routledge Handbook of Paleontology actually mentioned that hadrosaurs seem to have some sort of predisposition to tumor growth, specifically in the late Cretaceous. Maybe due to genetic reasons or the fact that they were prey species, so they seem to get injured more frequently, but Who knows? One hadrosaur in the genus Tilmatosaurus was found to have a facial tumor back in 2016. It was alive about 68 million years ago in the Valley of the Dinosaurs in what is now Romania, and was about 13 feet long. When it was first discovered, researchers noticed that the jaw was kind of warped due to outgrowths, and that was determined to be caused by ameloblastoma, which is a tissue growth that mammals and reptiles still get today. They're non-cancerous, so not directly dangerous, but potentially growing to a size that could have blocked the airways or led to some sort of difficulty in proper body functioning. Another hadrosaur abnormality was a case of septic arthritis back in 2016, something that affects mammals, birds, and reptiles still today, and is caused by a joint infection, usually after some sort of injury. In this case, the arthritis was found at the joint of the radius and ulna of a 70 million year old hadrosaur in what is now New Jersey. Scientists could see without any sort of equipment that the fossil was abnormal, and then a closer look with micro CT scans revealed the joint was fused and had some bony outgrowths all over it. They were able to rule out other possible causes like cancer or osteoporosis, and the severity of it suggested that the hadrosaur was dealing with it for a long time, likely limiting its ability to walk or use its arm. All right, let's move on to something different. Fuck. Like, malaria. If we had to rank diseases from favorites to least favorites, I think malaria would probably be at the bottom towards the least favorite of all time. I don't know what a favorite disease would be. I tried to look up best disease on Google, but best disease is actually a disease that affects your retinas. So I got nothing there. If you can think of a favorite disease, let me know in the comments. Maybe there's one that makes you bounce really high. All right, I'm gonna shut up. Back to what I was saying. Malaria, I'm certain you're familiar with it, is a horrible disease carried by mosquitoes that can infect a variety of different vertebrate animals. For example, the malaria that infects humans kills over 400,000 people a year. There's also avian malaria that has played a major role in the extinction of many birds in Hawaii in recent decades. Different kinds of malaria have evolved to infect different vertebrate hosts and be carried by a specific anopheline mosquito, a certain genus of mosquitoes. And some of them, out of the like 460 species, can carry malaria. Malaria was originally thought to have evolved relatively recently, like 15,000 to 8 million years ago. But a study published in 2016 by entomologist George Poynter Jr. suggests it evolved way earlier, at least 100 million years ago, with the first vertebrate hosts likely being reptiles, including the dinosaurs. By the way, George Poynter is a researcher at my alma mater, Oregon State University. OSU is consistently coming out with cool research on prehistoric shit. Just banger after banger. All right. Okay, so what was his evidence for this? Well, Poynter and his team were able to identify an insect trapped in amber from 100 million years ago.
Hey, I've seen this one. This is a classic.
That was infected with an ancient form of malaria. They were able to identify malarial oases all over it, which are like part of the malaria life cycle. Only this insect was not a mosquito. It was a biting midge. So he and his team thought at the time that earlier forms of malaria were carried by biting midges, and later on, like 20 million years ago, started using mosquitoes as the vector. But then in 2019, Poynter and his team found a mosquito with the same conditions, trapped in amber from 100 million years ago, infected with an ancient form of malaria. Specific characteristics of the mosquito, like their antenna, the shape of their wings, like the veins in their wings, and the shape of their abdomen suggested this was actually an early lineage of those anopheline mosquitoes. So the modern condition of malaria being carried by this specific mosquito genus seems to actually be ancient as well, and both biting midges and mosquitoes were carrying malaria during the age of the dinosaurs. While the ultimate cause of the extinction of the dinosaurs was obviously the asteroid that I'm going to make a video about during the History of Life series, there's lots of evidence to suggest that many dinosaur lineages were actually going extinct over thousands of years before the asteroid event even occurred. What those extinctions were due to could be a lot of things, but many diseases, including malaria, obviously, were emerging during this time and could have played a role. We just don't have evidence of that. All right, so what about the sniffles that I mentioned at the beginning of the video? The living relatives of dinosaurs today, i.e. birds and reptiles, are known to suffer from the occasional case of the suds. So one could assume dinosaurs did too. But how could you possibly know for sure? Respiratory disease affects lungs and soft tissues, which obviously are very rarely preserved. Well, just last year in 2022, scientists described the fossil of a juvenile sauropod that seemed to have a case of air sacculitis, an inflammatory respiratory disease that birds have today. The sauropod, named Dolly by scientists in 1990, was alive about 150 million years ago in what is now Montana. And the fossil includes a pretty complete skull and the first 7 neck vertebrae. So how did they know that Dolly got sick? Obviously, sauropods were really fucking big. Dolly, for example, would have been about 60 feet long as a juvenile. And some of the largest sauropods that we know of could get to like 130 feet long. Their necks were absolutely ridiculous, and the thought of them being able to hold up all that weight probably seems outrageous. Look at how big their bones were. Well, sauropods actually had, drumroll please, hollow bones. Yep. And a network of air sacs, like modern birds, making their necks lighter than they appear to be. Those air sacs had attachments to the vertebra in the neck. So when the air sacs got infected, it left evidence in the bones as lesions or scarring or other damage. It does the same to birds today, which have a similar setup. And that is what scientists saw when the bones were CT scanned. Clear signs of an infection that started in the air sacs and left a mark on the neck bones, and all in areas where the vertebra would have been attached to the air sacs. So, it clearly points to a respiratory infection. More specifically, a type of air sacculitis, based on the evidence. This would have given Dolly symptoms like weight loss, coughing, a runny nose, a fever, heavy breathing, and this likely caused, or at least contributed somewhat, to her early death, which is sad. But luckily, Dolly's remains have given scientists some really cool insight on something that is otherwise not documented well at all in the fossil record. Another one you might not expect to show up in the fossil record is tuberculosis. That's right, bitch. In 2018, scientists in Poland found possible evidence of tuberculosis in a marine reptile called Pronusticosaurus. Pronusticosaurus, alive about 245 million years ago. The fossil specimen was typical of their kind. They had flat skulls, long necks, and long, rounded teeth. But their ribs were unusual. They had lesions all over them that look similar to those that show up on the ribs of infected animals today. It mainly infects the lungs, but can also spread to other parts of the body like kidneys and even the brain, and obviously can impact the ribs. There was a list of reasons why these lesions could have been there. It might have been cancers or other infections, or maybe pneumonia, but maybe the tuberculosis caused the pneumonia. But they were able to rule those out by looking at different x-rays, histologies, CT scans. Tuberculosis seems to be the most likely cause, but this one is still technically up for debate. If it does end up being tuberculosis, this would push back the earliest case by, like, hundreds of millions of years. Before examining this fossil, the earliest record was in a marsupial from 3 million years ago. So, big, if true. Hopefully, we will get more answers soon. I know that talking about diseases can be a huge buzzkill. I found myself getting kind of bummed out while doing research for this video. But God, it's so cool that with the technology that we have, we can identify such small aspects of an individual's life from hundreds of millions of years ago. You know, that like connect us to them as individuals rather than groups. And who knows what we're gonna be able to discover in like 5-10 years, now that we're getting an idea of what to look for. All of this just adds to the knowledge that we have of these diseases today and could potentially move us in the right direction for, you know, different treatments or possibly cures. And that is so sick. All right, this week I'm only gonna feature one question in the Q&A because it needs its own spotlight. I don't know if you were messing with me, but your tone and the detail you included makes me think you weren't. So, let me just read the whole thing.
Here we go, buckle up.
Get my phone out. Hey Lindsay, question. On the topic of bugs getting into places they're not supposed to go, or places we humans would much prefer that they don't go, I recently had an ear canal infection and is still recovering. And all of a sudden, centipedes in my house are crawling into my ear during the night. It's annoying, it's painful, it's freaky. One of them bit me with their mandibles, so now the ear is hurting from both the infection and the venom. I've had to buy this giant earmuff thing just to sleep. So, what the fuck? The centipedes have never invaded my ears prior to this, and they have not touched my other ear before, during, and since. Did the infection lead to some sort of scent that they might have mistaken for food or whatever? Answer if you can, sister. Thanks. I have questions for you. First off.
What?
I have never come across a house centipede before, but I would like to know where you live, where it's just a normal occurrence to have a centipede infestation to the point where you're aware of the fact that they usually leave you alone. So you know they're usually there. They just don't usually go in your ear. And you just seem a little bit calm, you know? A little too calm. I don't have an answer for you. I'm gonna assume that it's what you said. They do like humid, dark environments, so maybe your ear is suddenly appealing to them. I don't know what to do about that. I don't know what you should do about that. I'm at a loss. So if you could get back to me with some more answers, I would very much appreciate that. If you have a weird animal you want identified or a question you want answered, let me know in the comments. Maybe I'll feature it next time. And if you like this video, be sure to subscribe so you don't miss my next long form video coming out next week. Check out my Patreon for our Discord server and live streams. And for now, stay curious. The world has a lot for us to learn. See ya!